Thank you all for coming out on this September evening to talk about something completely nonpartisan and yet very much in our purview right now, and that is presidential gardens. So I'd like to start by just telling you a little bit about how I came to write this book, because as Antonia said, I usually write about authors who garden. I wrote about Emily Dickinson and Beatrix Potter, and now I'm working on a book about Laura Ingalls Wilder, who wrote the Little House books. Yeah, that's a lot of fun. So I had called up my editor. He's actually in Portland, Oregon. So I've worked with Tom Fisher for a long time, but as is our kind of strange economy now, I've never met him face to face. So we only really deal over the phone and over the computer. And I said, Tom, I'm interested in writing a book about that crowd in Concord, Massachusetts, the transcendentalists, people like Emerson and Thoreau, Louisa May Alcott, Nathaniel Hawthorne. They all lived there and they all gardened together. And he said, that sounds great. I'd buy it, but I don't think anyone else would. Now, they're in business to sell books. Timber Press is a horticulture and botany publisher, but they really do like to sell books. And so he said, well, we haven't done a garden history of American garden history in a while. So what would you think about writing a history of gardening in the United States? Now, I should have felt like this guy, sort of flag-waving and happy on the cover of the Iowa Seed Catalog, but instead my feeling sitting at my desk in Chatham that day was more like this, American hero, as portrayed by Gregory Peck, you may recognize him, Captain Ahab. Now, Captain Ahab, as you may recall, went on this long obsessive chase, which eventually pulled him down at the end, and that was the way I felt about writing a history of gardening in the United States. After all, we are a big country. You know, what I can grow in New Jersey is different from what my brother-in-law grows in New Mexico and my cousin in Maine, and this doesn't even show Alaska and Hawaii. And depending on how you count, it's been a long history. So there's a lot of territory and time to cover. So I felt like this was going to take me the rest of my life and be a really kind of long, arduous process. And then I remembered one of my students. His name was Seamus McLennan. He was actually from South Africa. And at the end of my landscape history class, all the students do a short research project, and they give a 5-minute presentation, and they have to have a 2-page handout. And he had selected the gardens of the White House. And it was really fascinating to me. I learned a lot from it, as I do for many of my students, but I thought, aha. Now, my husband said, oh, you're going to go like in the long tradition of educators who steal their students' work? And I said, no, no, no. So, you know, I wrote to Seamus and made sure it was okay. And he said, yes, it's fine that I use his idea for this book. And you'll see his name in the acknowledgments. The other thing I like to do when I start a book is to find some personal connection. Now, I guarantee you, I have had no I'm not related to anyone who was president or first lady, but here's what I found. This is an image of the White House from around the turn of the 20th century. Okay, so plant ID for all of you gardeners. Do you recognize the plant in the bottom left-hand corner? Hydrangea, right, hydrangea. It's panicled hydrangea. They're all in bloom now. They're the ones that you see at the nursery. Most of them are trained up as a standard, so they're sort of growing up on a stick, and then they have this sort of lollipop form. And it's a very beautiful shrub. And here's what I found in my family photographs. The woman in the poke bonnet is my great-grandmother, Catherine Nealon. She was from Ireland, and she settled in central Illinois. And there is that same shrub. So here is a shrub that it's not native to the United States. It came in, and it was sort of transmitted across the country. And the White House, because it is our first garden, if you will, it does reflect. It's sort of a fashion funnel, right? You have all the stuff going on in the culture, but it does reflect in design, both interior but also outside, what's going on in the gardens around the country. So there was my solution, at least to that part. Then the question was, well, where do you start? Any of you James Michener fans? Any James? So I love James Michener. I remember sitting on the beach one summer with a copy of Hawaii and just loved it. And so, you know, James Michener, he would have started like something prehistoric, right? And I did actually write one prologue that started with things like blue-green algae. And my editor put like a big red question mark and sent it right back. So anyway, the book does not start there. It starts instead in 1608, when John Smith, with a small crew, takes a boat up the Potomac River. And he encounters that summer Indian villages, villages of America's first gardeners. So that's where the prologue starts. What did he find? He found agriculture. So they were growing the things that my fourth grade niece just learned about in summer camp, the Three Sisters, right? They were growing corn, squash, beans. They were also growing tobacco, which became very popular as a business enterprise for the Virginia colony and elsewhere. And they also grew something that I weed out of my garden. I get this little gray weed. It grows where it's dry, and it pops up, and it has, if you let it go to seed, it has these little seed pods that droop down. And I always called it goosefoot, but it turns out that they were growing it as a crop, and it's actually related to quinoa, you know, that very like she grain that everybody's eating now. So, you know, again, nothing new under the sun. So I go from there in the prologue to start talking about how our federal city ended up, you know, where it is at that sort of intersection of Virginia and Maryland, and discuss that, and then how the plan for the city got started. So George Washington never lived in the White House, but he certainly was involved in planning the federal city that eventually bore his name. And he hired a French architect that had worked for him during the Revolutionary War named Peter Charles L'Enfant. And L'Enfant designed a plan for this brand new city that was very French in style. He had grown up around Versailles, and so that's really what he knew as a young man. So he comes to America, he lays out this city. It's the reason why Washington, D.C. is impossible to drive around, right? It's got all these big diagonal avenues, all these circles. It's very geometric, not good for cars. And Washington, though, did put his own mark, particularly on the president's house, because instead of putting it exactly on the end of one of these axes, one of these long straight lines, he said, no, I want it more up on the hill. And he was really modeling it after Mount Vernon, right? And this kind of English style of putting the house up on the hill for a great view, also as it has, or had at least, a great view of the river, and also for the air quality, because they felt that that was much more healthful. And also, I'm sure, because you wanted your house up on the hill so everyone could see it. So the first president to actually live at the White House was John Adams. Very good. So John Adams moves in really before the White House is finished. And Abigail comes a couple of weeks later. They did move in on schedule, but there are famous stories of Abigail Adams hanging her wet laundry up in the unfinished reception rooms because, you know, it just wasn't finished. And she wrote to her daughter when she arrived at the president's house, "We have not the least fence, yard, or other convenience," meaning there was just really nothing there other than it was a construction site. She came in from Baltimore by carriage, and she wrote again to her daughter, "Woods are all you can see from Baltimore until you reach the city," and she underlined that, which is so only in name. So again, they did move in, but it really wasn't done. The president's house was under construction, the Capitol building was under construction, and the rest of it was basically a little village. So I thought, really, when I started this, that Thomas Jefferson would be my ace in the hole, right? Jefferson is sort of America's patron saint of gardening. He gardened his whole life. He gardened at Monticello. He actually had another garden at another plantation called Poplar Forest, both very interesting to go see. But while he was president, he was a two-term president. Adams just basically finished out his last year of his one term at the White House. Jefferson didn't garden much while he was there. He also was trying to get all the construction projects finished. And so he did a little bit of work with plants while he was president, but indoors, not outdoors. And in his cabinet, as he called it, his study at the president's house, he grew geraniums. That was the type of geranium he grew. It was a big sort of fuzzy red flowering geranium. You know, the ones we grow today are much more compact. But it was a relatively new and exotic plant at the time. He also grew roses in the window of his study. And his friend Margaret Bayard remembered that among the roses and geraniums, he kept a bird cage for his pet mockingbird. And the pet mockingbird's name was Dick. Now, when I read that, I burst out laughing, because when I was growing up, I remember heated arguments between my father and my older brother about Richard Nixon. And so I remembered that name connected with Nixon being bandied about at the dinner table. But truly, Jefferson loved mockingbirds. He often kept one or more for pets. He also told his children never disturb the wild mockingbirds. And I found it a little strange that he had wild birds for pets, but I found a catalog from the Midwest from around 1900, and they were still selling mockingbirds as pets. So, you know, I guess it wasn't that unusual at the time. So while Jefferson didn't do much planting at the president's house, he did a lot of planning before he left. He worked with an architect, Benjamin Latrobe, and he sort of set the front and backyard for the White House. The front yard is the one that you see basically behind all of the cable newscasters, whichever channel you may happen to watch. And it is the entrance with the pediment, the triangular pediment, and it was the main carriage entrance, and that is what they planned, the carriage approach. In the back is the round portico. That is the south portico. And Jefferson and Latrobe planned that much more as a park-like setting. He did abbreviate the grounds that were attached to the president's house. Originally, Washington and L'Enfant had in mind that they would go all the way to the Potomac. So if you can picture it, it would have included the Washington Monument grounds and all the way down to the river. Jefferson was very much for simple government, you know, small government. That's what his platform was when he was president. He always had his portrait painted in very simple clothing, did not want to look wealthy, and he cut off the president's grounds basically at the 18 acres that are currently the grounds of the White House. And he built a wall, which we will see later. So Jefferson does the planning, and it does sort of a combined French and English plan, and then the next president, James Madison, does the planting. So it was with Madison that I found the first plant lists for the president's grounds, and they included trees and shrubs, both native and exotic, many shrubs that you might have in your gardens, things like lilacs and roses and Rose of Sharon, but also lots of vegetables. So that's why the subtitle of the book says Madison's Cabbages to Kennedy's Roses. So lots of seed orders from places like Philadelphia, including things like cabbages and beets and turnips, which was very interesting to me, but I'm a bit of a plant nerd. He ordered from nurserymen, but he also was very aware of the Shakers. And it turns out that the Shakers, this group, it was sort of a community-based religion. They were celibate communities. I think there were only two or three left in the last community in Maine. But they got very famous. I knew them for furniture and baskets, but also for the quality of their seeds. So they grew the seeds, cleaned them, and then packaged them for sale. And the Shakers innovated something that we still use today, and that was the pre-printed standardized seed packet. So the next time you go to the garden center or the hardware store or the grocery store and pick up a packet of seeds, think about the Shakers. They also had a direct sales force because the Shaker brothers would go out and sell both farm to farm as well as on consignment to general stores. So they were very big in the seed industry. So James Madison does all of this planting, and then in 1814, what happens? The British come and burn the federal buildings, so they burn both the President's House and the Capitol and the other office buildings in Washington, D.C. in 1814. So it was rebuilt, and it was the next president, James Monroe, who got the planting done. Again, it was also after Monroe moved back in and the president's house had a very bright white coat of paint put on to cover up some of the char marks that it started being referred to as the White House. That wasn't official until the Teddy Roosevelt administration, but it started being used. To get the planting done, James Madison, former president, actually lends James Monroe his personal gardener, Charles Bizet, who was French. And I found the first receipt from 1822 for a bill, essentially, a bill from Charles Bizet to the Commissioner of Public Buildings. And it was interesting to me to see what Charles Bizet had been doing at the president's property. He'd been mowing, hand mowing. It's a big property to hand mow. He had some other ideas for that as well. He repaired tools and frames, and he spread a lot of manure. So I'll say that without comment. We start to see in the 1830s, the first images of the garden at the president's house. And so here again is that south portico. And you can see the flower garden. So it looks very ornamental. Again, you see people strolling around. So it was basically open. And also notice the flock of sheep. So that's the other way that they kept the lawn mowed. They would have a neighboring farmer bring in a flock of sheep. I love this image because it shows a picture of the president's gardener there with his shovel working out in the garden. And I got quite interested in the gardeners themselves, so interested that it started sort of yanking the book off track. This does happen. And so you'll find all the information, or most of it, about the president's gardeners in a section in the back. This particular gardener would have been an Irishman named John Ousley. John Ousley came in through Perth Amboy, and then he made his way to Washington, D.C., and started working at the president's house in 1825. He stayed there for 27 years. And that's not unique. Many of the gardeners have stayed there for a really long time. In fact, there have only been 13 head gardeners at the White House since the start. John Ousley is also important because he taught the next president, John Quincy Adams, how to garden. John Quincy Adams, now I will tell you, before I started this project, I knew that John Quincy Adams was the son of John Adams and Abigail Adams, and that's about where it ended. John Quincy Adams was very accomplished. He was a diplomat. He was a lawyer. He taught at Harvard Law School before he was president. He was in the Senate. Then he won the presidency almost by accident. So he and Andrew Jackson, and then there was a third candidate. This is like that joke about the three tenors where you can never remember the third one. But anyway, the third candidate, they had a very heated race, and no one had a clear majority, either on the Electoral College side or on the popular side. So it got thrown to the House of Representatives, and through a sort of deal with the third candidate, John Quincy Adams actually came out ahead. It may have even been true that Andrew Jackson won the popular vote. So at any rate, you can imagine from the moment that John Quincy Adams had his inauguration, Andrew Jackson's supporters were sort of hurling rocks at him. Oh. Not literally, but you know what I mean. So he was sort of a miserable president. If you read his diaries, which are all online, thanks to the Massachusetts Historical Society, you can read all 41 volumes. They are all in his handwriting. They haven't been transcribed, but his handwriting's pretty good. Or you can go there, which I also did, but you can read them online. I did not read 41 volumes of his diaries. I concentrated on the period when he was president. And he talks about really kind of being depressed. And, you know, all the work he did, he was an early riser. He'd get up early in the morning, he'd exercise in various ways. And eventually, he discovered gardening. So he came to gardening rather late, but he really took to it. So he would get up at 4 in the morning and, you know, go for a walk and then go out and work in the garden. And John Ousley taught him the Latin names of plants and really how to do things like propagate. And John Quincy Adams fell in love with trees and really started studying them. Also, wherever he went, he would pick up tree seeds. So, you know, if he were walking along somewhere, he would pick up acorns or chestnuts or, you know, whatever, walnuts. And if he was eating something with a seed in it, he'd basically save the seeds. So he would plant pears and apples and oranges and things like that. And I found in Boston at the Historical Society, I'm looking at microfilm. You remember microfilm, right? It's all black and white. And I come across this image. It's a tiny little seedling in a flower pot. It's all in black and white. But up at the top, in his handwriting, is written when he planted it, how big it grew after so many weeks, when he transplanted it, then how big it was after a year, and then when he transplanted it to the garden. Now, this was very exciting to me. Again, I'm a plant person. And so I email it to myself. You could do that on the microfilm reader. And I get home and I write to the reference librarian, I'd like to get permission to use this in my book. And she said, that's great. Where is it? And I said, what do you mean, where is it? It's, you know, it's on this microfilm reel. She said, no, where is it physically? And I said, I have no idea. So I went back to Boston. That's a little lesson. And we did eventually find it. It was on the microfilm. It was in with the diary. But because it was a loose sheet of paper, it ended up in a box of, you know, miscellaneous archival materials. So it's in color, it's in the book, it's very exciting. So anyway, there it is. So John Quincy Adams, my new hero, then, you know, he had a wonderful life. He goes back into the House of Representatives after he's president and serves till the very end of his life. He actually died in the Capitol building and was a very staunch supporter of abolition and all those things. Okay, so Andrew Jackson comes roaring in next after that one term. You know, very popular, a war hero, real populist. And I know he was totally cool because I found this image on the internet. So, you know, you can find everything on the internet. But truly, he was hugely popular. His inaugural party at the White House was so raucous that they had to put barrels of whiskey out in the garden to sort of pull some of his supporters out so that they could sort of whisk the president to safety. And to be honest, Andrew Jackson must have been sad at the time, because right before the inauguration, as he's about to leave his home in Tennessee, his wife Rachel dies quite suddenly. And the story goes that he brought saplings, small trees, cutting something of a southern magnolia from Tennessee and planted them at the White House near the South Portico. They are still there. They are held up, when I tell you cabling, I've never seen cabling like this. There's a giant thing that looks like a flagpole, and they're all sort of cabled to that, all the branches. The old $20 bill, several iterations ago, had the magnolias showing there. So whether it's just White House lore, but they have always been called the Jackson Magnolias, so I'm sure that there is some truth to it, although I have never been able to find exactly when they were planted. So after Andrew Jackson, I had a little bit of a problem, actually a set of problems. There were things like, you know, Van Buren, Harrison, Tyler Polk, Taylor, you know, that's long string of presidents. I'm sorry if any of them are your favorites. There wasn't much to say about them related to the garden. I did have a couple of images. Polk was a great admirer of Jefferson. He actually moved the statue from the Capitol rotunda out to the president's front yard, and that's Jefferson. Jefferson is now back in the Capitol rotunda. Some images that show things like the ironwork and the trellising, just to show the styles of the period. But it was really then James Buchanan, who's right before Abraham Lincoln, where the next big stylistic change happens, and that is a conservatory gets put on to the west side of the White House, a proper conservatory for display. Buchanan's niece, Harriet Lane, acted as his first lady, and she was very popular with the press, so there were descriptions of her conservatory and pictures of it. And this was very popular nationwide. It starts appearing in photographs like this one. You can just make it out on this side. And the conservatories over the years kept getting bigger and bigger. And so you'll see several pictures of them. This image also shows Thomas Jefferson's wall, circa 1860. You'll see some people lounging around on this. Again, this is sort of the backyard, if you will, the south lawn of the White House. And I learned from this image that we did not invent graffiti in the 20th century. I was sort of shocked and horrified. So again, my mother grew up in Lincoln, Illinois, so we always loved President Lincoln. The president himself was a little too busy to bother much with the gardens, but his wife, Mary Todd Lincoln, loved flowers. She was often photographed in her finery with bouquets of flowers. And she also had a bit of a buying problem. Now, nowadays we call it retail therapy. She loved to spend money on clothing and also furnishings. Now, again, to argue on her behalf, the White House was fairly shabby at the time. And so she was buying fabrics and upholstery and rugs and things, but she quickly ran out of money. Her gardener said that he could help her out. And he said, you know, I'll just make it look as though I bought more seeds, plants, you know, soil, and then you can use that money to pay off your creditors. Now, if there are any accountants in the house, you will know that this is a no-no. Even though, you know, no one was pocketing the funds, this is still definitely a no-no. And, you know, John Watt, the gardener at the time, got found out. Congress started calling it the manure fund. That was cut off. He got fired. I don't know what Mrs. Lincoln did to pay her bills after that. Abraham Lincoln, again, not too involved in the garden, although I did find some diary entries from Walt Whitman, who lived in Washington and worked as a nurse during the Civil War, of his memories of the White House grounds at the time. So I found that very touching and included those. Also, again, from that period, I found the first plan sort of as built, if you will, for the White House grounds. This is a map that's now in the National Archives. College Park has all the maps, College Park, Maryland. You can see the map has had some hard times, but it does show things like on the left-hand side here, those are the conservatories. Again, being extended over time. Just off the conservatories, it's a whole area that's like a mini farm. So there are all rows of vegetables, and there are descriptions of fruit trees at the time. So again, you have to think of it almost as a gentleman's farm. The presidents were helping to, you know, get food on the table, if you will. Also, it all came out of their own pockets at the time, all the entertaining. We see this sort of squash-shaped driveway. Guitar, cello, I don't know what you'd call that shape. And that was reminiscent of Mount Vernon. It was a very popular sort of design for drives at the time, little round fountains in the middle, and then these two things at the bottom. Can you see them? At the bottom of the drive. So there was a congressman named Ogle. That was his last name, Congressman Ogle. And he did not like the spending that was going on at the president's house. And he gave this long speech to Congress, and he called those two mounds Amazon's bosoms. So he was not impressed. For years, they were called the Jefferson Mounds, because it was thought that Thomas Jefferson designed them. Now people aren't quite so sure. They think they put them in a little later, but they're still there. So if you go and look at the south grounds of the White House, you'll still see these two kind of hummocks. And they were there to give the visitor, when you entered, a sort of surprise. You know, when you come around, you get a new view. Rutherford B. Hayes. So Rutherford B. from Ohio, I now remember Rutherford B. rhymes with tree. Because he was a great planter of trees, both at his home in Ohio and at the president's grounds. And he really started the tradition of commemorative tree planting that still goes on today. He and his wife, Lucy Webb Hayes, were also well known for being temperance advocates. And during their term, the White House was dry. Later on, people started calling her Lemonade Lucy. Instead of serving alcohol after dinner, you know, a little after dinner drink, they would take people around the conservatories and show them that as the end of the party. Their Secretary of State at the time said of one of their parties, "It was a brilliant affair. The water flowed like champagne." So anyway, he didn't think much of it. But they did expand the conservatories and broke doors through to the state dining room so that their guests could come straight out. They brought with them from Ohio their gardener, Henry Pfister. He was from Switzerland. He was trained in Europe. Again, came to America, made his way to Cincinnati, which was really a boom town at the time, and then comes with them to Washington and stays for 25 years. Again, there's sort of that theme. This is a picture of Mr. Pfister in one of the conservatories, one of the glass houses, again, attached to the west side, watering the plants. And he also took care of the outside. And look, by this time, so this is now towards the end of the 19th century, it's getting to be what we now think of as Victorian. Carpet bedding, potted palm trees, very elaborate. That's the front lawn of the White House. Trust me, it no longer looks like that. I took a little sort of diversion to talk about a main focal point of the landscape from the president's house. So here's the White House. I know it's a little blurry there. And there is the unfinished Washington Monument. Now, the Washington Monument had a kind of long, not so illustrious history of building. It was started in 1848 by private subscription. So they went around and asked people for donations. It ran out of money. Then it sat unfinished for a while. Then there was the Civil War. Nothing happened again. And actually, the grounds became sort of an army encampment. And then after the Civil War, the project was sort of given over to the Army Corps of Engineers, who then finished it. And if you look at it today, you will see where the stone color changes because they couldn't exactly match the stone. But it was completed. It was considered one of the great wonders of the world. This illustration in Harper's has an outline of the monument and then all sort of world monuments that would fit inside. So they stack in like the pyramids and St. Peter's in Rome. And they're saying, you know, this is the Washington Monument. It's the biggest thing ever, which it actually was. And in 1885, they had a big party with fireworks, and Chester A. Arthur was president then. I had to include Chester A. Arthur somehow because he went to Union College in Schenectady, which is where my husband graduated. So there you go. Okay, President Grover Cleveland, New Jersey, right? He's Cleveland, yeah. So he actually has several presidential trivia items attached to him, so you can remember this for your next bar bet. He was the only president who has had two non-consecutive terms, exactly. So Benjamin Harrison is in the middle of the Grover Cleveland sandwich, and he is the only standing president to have married in the White House. So he marries Frances Folsom. It's a big to-do. They have all sorts of flowers, all grown in the conservatories, which is the way it was done at the time. And there is a picture from the paper the day of their wedding announcement showing the president's house kind of filled in, the trees have grown in, and look at the size of the conservatories. By this time, there was an orchid house and a rose house, and they did all the propagation of annuals. And if you think the artist is exaggerating, there is a photograph. So it was really, you know, quite vast and quite extensive. Mrs. McKinley, as moving on, loved to sit in the conservatories. The gardeners would bring a chair in for her. She was an invalid. She had epilepsy and wasn't very strong. Sadly, her husband was assassinated, and he loved carnations. So every day the gardener would bring him a fresh bouquet of carnations. He always wore a carnation as a boutonniere. And so for many years after his assassination, on his birthday, America celebrated Carnation Day on January 29th in his memory. So after McKinley is assassinated, his vice president becomes president. And that was, anyone know? Teddy Roosevelt. You guys are good. So Teddy Roosevelt comes in. He's very young. I think he's the youngest person to ever become president, maybe not the youngest person elected. I think that's the way it went, because he wasn't elected for his first term. And then he comes in with his big family. And the White House was very crowded. Even with the kids doubled up, it was tough, because he also had to work in that same main building, you know. And so he's going to do something about that before long. I loved Teddy Roosevelt, even more after doing this. For one reason, I discovered that he wrote picture letters to his children. In other words, he'd write letters, but he'd do little drawings. And I had done this book about Beatrix Potter, who did the same thing. When she was writing to children, she'd include little pictures. This is a letter to his daughter, Ethel, and he draws a picture of Ethel administering discipline to her two little brothers, Quentin and Archie, who were really characters. Teddy Roosevelt was also an avid bird watcher and kept lists of the birds that he spotted while he was president. He provided them to one of the local bird societies. He was great in terms of preservation and making bird sanctuaries and basically our national park system. There are his two little boys who were, there are great stories in the book that I don't have time for about Quentin and Archie and the things that they would do on the White House grounds, which included things like carving a baseball diamond in the lawn. But Teddy decided, no, I need more room. So he hires Charles McKim of McKim, Mead & White, very famous architectural firm, to basically do an addition for him. And so they tear off all of the conservatories from the west side in 1900, and that is when the predecessor to the west wing was built. The plants were saved. There again is Quentin Roosevelt helping to move some of the plants. There he is up a tree. And they were moved to other greenhouses near the Washington Monument, which were the propagating grounds at the time. Even some of the glass houses themselves were moved. And then Roosevelt and Edith, his wife Edith Roosevelt, also put in a colonial revival garden flanking the new West Wing. Colonial revival, very big deal at the turn of the 20th century. Little edges of boxwood, roses, old-fashioned flowers, that sort of thing. And Edith had her portrait painted in that garden and her photograph taken. And when Teddy Roosevelt was referring to the garden to his children, he always called it Mother's Garden. So I found that very endearing. They used to have breakfast on the south portico under the awnings. When Taft comes in, he brings in the automobile, and that starts bringing its changes. But it was Helen Taft who made more of an impact on the sort of grounds of the extended sort of president's territory, at any rate, and that was the cherry trees. Without Helen Taft, I don't think it would have happened. There were two other people very much involved. There was a woman who was a journalist and a member of the National Geographic Society who was quite enchanted with Japan. And then a gentleman botanist named David Fairchild, who worked for the federal government and also loved Japanese cherry trees. But it was Helen Taft that really got it going and got that planting going. And now we have things like the Cherry Tree Festival in Branch Brook Park. So it got popular around the country. Mrs. Wilson, the first Mrs. Wilson, ushers in yet another style to the president's grounds, and that is Italianate. Ellen Wilson was an artist and also a gardener. She loved a garden, and she had a friend who had worked with them in Princeton when they were at Princeton, Beatrix Jones, and she had Beatrix Jones design an Italianate garden. She didn't, unfortunately, live, Mrs. Wilson, that is, to see that installed. She died during the presidency, and it was the second Mrs. Wilson. Woodrow Wilson remarried just basically 1 year later. He was evidently quite smitten with both his first wife and with this second woman, Edith Bowling Gault, and he wrote to her and said, "You are the only woman I know who can wear an orchid. On everybody else, the orchid wears the woman." So there is Edith with one of her orchids. And there they are in the Italianate garden that the first wife designed and the second wife had installed. Of course, there was the First World War during the Wilson administration, and there were things like meatless Mondays and wheatless Wednesdays, and at the White House, sheep came back to mow the lawn. So with the idea of the manpower shortage, one of the gardeners who did not serve in the army actually acted as the shepherd, and the wool was shorn and sold for the Red Cross at auction. And we had in America the first round of war gardening. I love this poster because actually the potatoes and things all have little faces. Between the wars, it was, you know, again, it's sort of the roaring 20s. That gets kind of done up at the White House as well. This is Mrs. Harding congratulating the tennis winner at the White House tennis courts. Teddy Roosevelt had introduced the tennis courts, but I love her outfit. It reminds me of Lady Mary on Downton Abbey.
Yes.
The Hardings weren't especially popular with the press, except for their dog, which was a big Airedale named Laddie Boy. The Hardings were newspaper people. prior to becoming politicians, and they would actually hold press conferences for Laddie Boy. So, you know, they knew how to work up a routine. I did read a Boston paper where they interviewed Laddie Boy and asked him if he would run for president. during the Second World War, sort of victory gardening comes back, and it comes to the White House itself. Neither Eleanor nor Franklin worked on the White House grounds, but one of the presidential advisors, Harry Hopkins, his daughter, had a small victory garden there. And again, there are wonderful stories in the book about Eleanor and Franklin hosting the King and Queen of England. It was the first time that a British monarch came to visit the White House, right? We'd had that falling out, actually two of them. So they hosted the first visit, and she worried a little bit about the gardens, but it went fine. Love this picture of Truman. My father was a great fan of Harry Truman, and love this Truman with the magnolia. Now, Harry Truman, you know, he wasn't crazy about the White House, and Bess Truman didn't like it at all. They wanted a little privacy. The White House must be a difficult place to live in a way, though you have plenty of help. You know, you have no privacy. And so Harry Truman wanted to build a little balcony on the south portico. So here is sort of, this is a model that he presents to Congress. Here's the way it was. So there are the awnings that Teddy Roosevelt and Edith Roosevelt used to have breakfast under. And Harry Truman said, what I want to do is take off the awnings and instead insert a little balcony coming off the second floor where we can have some outdoor space that is private. And, of course, Congress starts to call this Harry's porch, and he gets all sorts of grief over it. But they eventually put it on. I think it cost something like $15,000, so it was a real bargain. And it's still used. I'm sure it's still a place that the first family really enjoys. I do blame Harry Truman, however, for America's passion for instant gardening. So if you watch any of those HGTV shows where they say, oh, well, you know, you can have a garden in a weekend, a new garden. Don't believe it. It takes a long time to have a real garden. But Harry Truman sort of rolls out the lawn, puts in these giant shrubs, which are still called the Truman Boxwoods. They're in front of the North Portico, and plants a full-size cherry tree in bloom. So instant gardening. Dwight Eisenhower puts in a putting green. He's not putting, but anyway. This is the only picture I could find of him putting. This is a cartoon from the Washington Post where they have the squirrel dropping acorns on poor President Eisenhower's head. President Kennedy comes in to the White House. I still remember Jacqueline Kennedy's tour of the interior, the newly redecorated interior, but it was her husband who was much more interested in the gardens. And he hires a family friend, Rachel Lambert Mellon, Bunny Mellon, to redesign the gardens. They put in a new garden for President Kennedy right outside the Oval Office, the Rose Garden that we still know today. By the way, when they were doing the construction, they cut through one of the national security telephone lines. And they actually did kick off a very brief atomic alert. So always call before you dig. It doesn't have as many roses as I expected. There are rose bushes, but it has crab apples and two magnolias and a lot of tulips. They ordered 3,000 tulips. Rachel Bunny Mellon designed another garden for the east side, so sort of the partner garden, but sadly this was just about to go in when the Kennedys left for Dallas. So it wasn't actually installed until the next administration, the Johnson administration, though the garden was dedicated to Jacqueline Kennedy. The gardens have been used for all sorts of things, from weddings to parties. This was the bicentennial, where the Queen of England is toasting President Ford, and there's Vice President Nelson Rockefeller. And she was very brave because she said, Mr. President, history is not a fairy tale. And she went on to talk about the burning of the White House, which seemed very brave given where the party was, which is right outside the West Wing. It's been used for diplomacy. There's Jimmy Carter and Anwar Sadat, the president of Egypt. It's been used for children. Also, Jimmy Carter with his daughter, Amy, up in the treehouse he had built for her, and his grandson. And it's been used for puppies. You remember Millie, right? And Barbara Bush. And it's been used for art exhibits. This is on the East Side, and there was a whole series of modern art exhibits during the Clinton administration. Trees continue to be planted. There's George W. Bush and Laura Bush planting a tree on the North Side, and the trees are magnificent. So that's the thing I've been most impressed about, really, about the White House grounds. Of course, I'm a vegetable gardener, so I love the fact that vegetables have gone back to the White House lawn starting in 2009. But who knows what will happen to that. Only the next president will be able to determine that. So I do have to say, I never flew a drone over the White House. I did not climb the fence, although sometimes I kind of wondered if I'd have to. Actually, it was my congressman, Rodney Frelinghuysen, and his staff who really helped me get access to the White House grounds. It is usually open 2 weekends a year for a sort of open day. You need a timed ticket, so you should check with your congressman if you want to go. It is a mob scene. I don't know if you can see all the people crowded in there, and many things are roped off. This was as close as I could get to the Rose Garden that day. But I was looking for one thing in particular. I had read an article that said I think it was the 70s, maybe it was the 60s, they got a full-size statue of a male deer, right, a stag, and the gardener had placed it outside the Oval Office in honor of Harry Truman, who used to say, "The buck stops here." And there it is. Can you see it? It's sort of tucked into the hedge, but it is still there. There was no sign. No one pointed it out, but there it was. I thought that was so funny. I did get to go to the White House one day in August, 2 years ago, to see the grounds in operation and to walk around with the head of horticulture, Jim Adams. So they were very busy putting in new annuals for the fall that day. The vegetable garden is absolutely gorgeous. There's also a pollinator garden nearby. Jim Adams and his staff work like tornadoes. He's nonstop. I don't know if you can see in his pocket, he's got he's been deadheading and weeding as we've been walking. And, he's been answering my questions and he's been stuffing it in his pockets just like I do. So I hope you've enjoyed this whirlwind tour of White House history. Thank you. I do have to add, I did not go down with the whale, as it turns out. It did take occasional Alka-Seltzer, as I'm sure it does for most presidents and first families. It is a beautiful place that we can all be proud of. I think of it as our common ground. And I will just end with a quote from Irv Williams, who has the record holder for the longest standing White House head gardener. He held that position for 45 years, and he once said, "What's great about the job is that our trees, our shrubs, know nothing about politics." Thank you. Thank you very much.